Greetings, African Queen Mother Warrior Isis.
Greetings, African Queen Mother Warrior Sister Dr. Sandra.
Thank you so much for agreeing to just be part of this thing that this idea that I've had. And it's very unscripted, and it's very, I want it to be very honest and open and just, you know, I don't want it edited, I just want it raw. I'm saying that because I have asked a few people that I respect to be part of this, it's kind of like an experiment really, where I'm just talking to people that are my friends, people that I know. And if in this conversation, at any point, because we're recording, if you don't want me to keep the recording, I'll delete it. But I think that because I've spoken to you so many times and I've got an idea of where you are. So I figure, let me see if I can do this and how it works. So, first of all, people won't know who you are. People may not know who I am. So should we introduce ourselves? And do you want to go first? Or do you want me to go first? Or
I'm cool, my queen. Whichever works best. Perhaps you start as you're the host.
Okay. Person. I recognize, actually, that your name is coming up as not your name. So I don't know.
Julia.
I'm relatively new to Zoom. So I'll rename it. Because you're coming up as a number. You're not a number.
I know. It's sometimes it happens. Yeah. Usually, I have a Zoom account. It should automatically take me on the iPad to my Zoom account. My name should come up, but sometimes it just, it's very temperamental technology.
Well, I think I've done it now.
Oh, no.
Is that okay?
You've got the African Queen Mother Warrior title in there. Wow.
Yes. Well, I think it's important to address you properly and introduce you properly. So I'm Sister Dr. Sandra Richards, and I'm an African. I'm an African living in the diaspora, which for people who don't know what that means, it means I don't live on the continent of Africa. I live in the world. So, but I'm still an African, because if you put a cat in an oven, it doesn't become a cake. So I'm an African. I'm very comfortable with that. There's an increasing population of us who feel comfortable with that kind of African, and not the black British or the Caribbean or the, you know, Trinidadian, but just to say, okay, first of all, I identify in this way. Spirit having an earth experience. I'm a mother, grandmother, daughter, sister, activist, researcher, and other things. But I'm in this conversation, I'm hoping that we're friends talking. So before we go into it further, do you want to introduce yourself?
So thank you for inviting me, first of all, to the conversation. So I'm, as you put up there, Isis, Sister Isis, Isis Amlak. I use Isis as my poet's name for creative purposes. I'm an African born in Trinidad and Tobago. Currently, kind of, at the moment, in a situation where I'm in the UK, in London, but I'm not a person of the UK, clearly. I spend my time traveling around on the continent and in the diaspora. So yes, I'm here in the cold, and I am many things, I do many things. I'm an activist first. I'm a poet. I'm also someone that's worked in delivering community and voluntary services in that sector, that not-for-profit sector, running organizations, running projects, etc., etc. And I am a mother and a daughter and a sister, not a grandmother yet. No rush for that yet. I have been with me, no rush for grandchildren or anything like that yet. Yes, and I'm here. I do many things, and I am many places.
Right. I know you're also a broadcaster. You also do a number of creative things.
Radio show, yeah. On two radio stations, yeah.
Right.
And then you forgot about that.
Yeah. And then that's the thing, isn't it? I think there may be a tendency to say, you know, oh, you're a researcher, or you're a mother, or you're a this or that. But actually, we do lots of different things, and we do them very, very well. So I claim it all. I claim it all, you know. So I didn't want to miss out anything. And I think other things will come up as we talk. But one of the reasons why I wanted to have a conversation with you is because you really, really get what it is to be a woman activist in a European environment, connecting with our brothers and sisters pan, so in the States, in the Caribbean, in the wherever, you know, we recognize that we are family wherever we are. We also recognize that in the movement, this Pan-African movement, that the voice of the woman isn't always heard, appreciated, understood, valued. The role can, if we're not careful, be dictated to us by others. And I just thought it was worth talking about that, among other things, because I don't think we should compromise our womanhood for our activism, or our activism for our womanhood. And I get from you when we talk that you have your views on that too, which may be the same, maybe slightly different, but certainly I know that you know that as women, maybe we need to have a conversation.
Yeah, it's really like walking a tightrope in many ways, because I mean, you mentioned earlier all the things that I am. I'm a Pan-Africanist. I'm committed to the Pan-African vision of united Africa, united African people, the reparations activists as yourself. That's how we met, in fact. And I'm obviously committed to the struggle, the fight, the realization of reparations, reparatory justice for our ancestors, for our enslavement, those of us in the diaspora, and for the colonization of our continent, and obviously the continued exploitation of our continent. So those are very strong commitments that require a high degree of activism, organizing, unity, collective work and responsibility, etc., collective economics, or, you know, all the principles of, that we're now celebrating in the Kwanzaa period, and Ngozi Saba. Yeah. So with that position, and I also describe myself as a womanist. I never use the feminist word, as that's a Eurocentric notion. It pits man against woman, and that's basically, that's for white people. Let them, you know, if you want to be a feminist, you're a white woman, that's all good. Do your thing. I'll do my thing. I'm a womanist. So I believe in the upliftment of the entire African nation. But within the concept of womanism is about respect, as you said, it's about value. It's about recognizing that we, you know, we as women are the creators. So that is a tightrope, because as people who've come out of the horrors of the Mahangamizi and the Mahafa that we have, we carry scars, psychological scars, not alone the physical things that we face. And damaged people that have been damaged, though resilient as we are, and kind of like magical almost as we are as Africans, there is an element of damage that rears its head in spaces where men and women are supposed to work in unity. Mm. And it rears itself in the form of misogynoir, is the term they're using now. Patriarchy, because the world is governed by Eurocentric patriarchal systems, and as much as we are Africans fighting against those systems, we are still within that web almost. We're in that web, though we're tearing it apart. So one of the things that does come up a lot with our brothers is this kind of the struggle between the man and the woman, the African man and the African woman, and it can represent itself in, as you said, us being devalued, our voices being silenced, men feeling that they should be making the decision because they are leading the struggle. And it's a huge problem, because at the same time, we have to work together as a people in order for this to work. But how do we address this, we call it elephant in the room, this issue that relates to us as African women? Because without us, there would be no African men. We birthed them. And how do we get them to understand that actually many of the behaviors, opinions and views that I see and that you see and that other queens have recognized in this Pan-African reparations, activist, Africanist movement are not derivative from our history? Because in history, African women were revered. I mean, we see that anyway, don't we? The way mothers and grandmothers. And how do we see that a lot of that comes from a Eurocentric domination of our cultures and also comes from a hurt or damage to the male ego, which is represented in trying to destabilize or usurp the power of the woman.
Yeah. You know, the risk, if there is any, of having a conversation like this is where people often go to, which is that if you speak of being a womanist, feminist, or whatever it is, you're against the man. And we are not against the man. In fact, we love the man so much. The man doesn't understand the ways in which we love the man. The man, the African man, is loved by us in so many different complex ways that manifest differently from notions of Eurocentric love or romantic love. So like you, I feel very comfortable and stand firmly in the space of a womanist. I'm a woman. I don't really understand, even though I've studied some of it and I've been around women who claim the identity of feminists. I don't understand it. Some of my close friends proclaim themselves to be feminists. And I say to them repeatedly, I don't understand what that is. I don't really understand it. Because the root of it, I understand it's based on principles that do not emanate from us. It doesn't, as I understand it, acknowledge principles of ma'at in the way that we do, the whole thing about balance. It really, for me, well, let me not even speak about it. Let me speak about womanism, because that's where I feel comfortable. So if I don't really understand feminism, I shouldn't try and critique it, because I think the first thing my friends would say is, you're not in a position to critique it. And they would be right in some ways. In some ways they'd be right. But I think that what I've seen of it, what I've read about it in theory, and what I've seen about it in terms of practice of feminists causes me some concern. The African family needs balance. It needs unity. It needs a peace. It needs harmony. It needs a number of things that I think are embraced by the principles of Ma'at. And so in that, if I wish to speak sternly and firmly to my African family, including my African men, then that's what I'll do. I don't see that love means I have to speak quietly or to be submissive or to watch us walk into danger because a man is doing it. I think side by side, balanced, considered and contemplated is what needs to happen to move the African family forward. And you referred to how we met. I don't know if you want to just recall that, because that was for me, that was a great, great time. I met some amazing sisters. You are one of them. And when I met you, it wasn't like a stranger. I had no issue with just embracing you. And you didn't seem to have any problem with embracing me. So do you want to say how we met?
Yeah. So yes, in 2014 at the last, and in fact there's not been one since, the last CARICOM reparations conference in Antigua. And yes, that was fascinating meeting you, and also a shout out to our African Queen Mother, Dr. Chenzera, who is again, an amazing, amazing African woman. Phenomenal. And I always take away from that, I know we talk about that, there were dynamics going on with the man and the woman in that space. Mm. At one point, there were men trying to silence women's voices, speak over them, challenging women about having opinions that deviated from their own, but in a very kind of masculine, egotistical way. Mm. There's challenging and there's challenging. And one of the things in terms of balance, because, you know, equal but different is how I see our role. We are equal in every way. There's equity, but we have different roles to play. You don't, you know, the hand has got five fingers, but each finger plays a different role. Each finger does a different thing. The body has many parts. They all play, but they're all about the survival of the being. All, you know, so when I saw what struck me when I saw Sister Doctor yourself, your energy, that we just connected, and I felt that real power of the African woman coming together. And, you know, so much so that you allowed me to stay in your room the last night. You just like invited me into your space. I mean, that's like an intimate space. So I always give thanks for that. But also watching African Queen Mother Dr. Chenzera and her king, the dynamics there, that was such a balance of power. As everyone was sat around the table, and she sat at a seat at the table, and he stood behind her like a pharaoh.
Yes, I remember that. And so you had Sister Doctor, African Queen Mother, Sister Dr. Chenzera sitting there, and her beloved king man, Nebkara, standing, holding the energy behind her. It was
powerful. And when Nebkara was asked why he was to introduce himself, he said, "I'm here to protect my queen," basically, because there has been, because of her work as an activist, she has encountered various negative energies in her travels, and I'm not prepared to allow that to happen. And he's a man of such wisdom and knowledge and experience, and yet he said very little in that conference. It was her voice that was heard. He made a couple of contributions, but in general, he was there to guide energies away from her, negative energies, and to protect her. And that, to me, was just like, wow, why aren't we seeing more of that? Imagine a conference where African queen warriors, mothers and sisters and daughters were sat around a table and their kings were humble enough and were able to put ego aside and put their women first and stand there to protect their
energy. That would be phenomenal. But imagine. Even if the you know, queens were not there with their particular beloved partner, just to have the respect in the space when we are all on the same side would be phenomenal. I remember in the conference, and not just that conference, in other spaces I've been in as well, where the man has taken great, I don't know, like it's almost pleasure in silencing a woman. And it actually happened in the conference as well. I mean, it was resolved after, because members of the conference responded in a particular way when certainly I was, you know, I had made a contribution, and there was a pushback from someone in particular who I actually admire greatly. We resolved it at the end, but you know, just to know that when we come together, that we don't have to be in a relationship with you, you know, like an intimate physical relationship with you. We're actually in a movement with you. We're in the same movement. So we are to hold you in high esteem, and you are to hold us in high esteem, and we are to hold each other in high esteem. And when I met you, it wasn't an issue for you to be within my intimate space, because you're family and we're in a movement. You know what I mean? So it, to me, is important that we take care of each other. We don't need to know too many circumstances. We just need to know we're in a movement. This is the situation now. This is a war. We need to keep each other safe. That's it.
Mm.
That's it. And there are other ways of knowing, I think. Our spirit tells us things. Our spirit tells us this person is okay, or this person, be careful, or this, you know what I mean? And I got no indication at all that, you know, I should do anything other than what I did. Do you know what I mean? And then it was fun. Even though we were doing something serious, it was fun because there was a sisterhood forming. You know?
Yeah, it was the needs of sisterhood.
Yeah, the sisterhood is so important. So very important. So, and it has lasted for over 6 years. And maybe even before that, maybe even before we met, because you have been an activist out of the UK, right? Right. So you're familiar with some of the shenanigans. Let's use that term. Shenanigans of the government, of various legislation, policies, activism, and such forth that people outside of the UK often don't know about. So we hear a lot about what happens in the States. You know, yeah. American Africans are doing this, that, and the other, and, you know, it gets marketed and promoted and it goes viral and stuff. But the stuff we're doing here in the UK. So you've been involved in a number of things for many, many, many years. Like,
yeah. I mean, I suppose the thing that I started doing in the 80s was the anti-apartheid stuff, but it wasn't an all-African organization. It was a very Eurocentric kind of left-wing organization, a non-stop picket outside the South African embassy, Azania, as I came and now call it. And it was through that, actually, that I became very closely associated with the PAC, the Pan-African Congress of Azania. And it was through them that I started my journey on Pan-Africanism, and I kind of moved away from the Eurocentric organization. Because the more I learned about it, the more I was like, well, though, of course, this Eurocentric organization, to their credit, was supportive of the PAC when the mainstream Pan-African anti-apartheid was only supporting the ANC. And the fundamental difference with the Pan-Africanist Congress is that the Pan-Africanist Congress, you had to be a Zanian to be a member anyway, i.e. had to be African. They also had colored members who were, some of them were Asian, but that you couldn't be like a white member. Like the ANC had these, a lot of white Jewish members. And also the freedom, the land, the freedom charter, the issue around land redistribution. In the PAC, it was clear, it was like along the lines of, you know, that what Mugabe was talking about repatriating the land, giving the land back, the stolen land, returning it. And the ANC weren't about that. And as you can see, they're not about that. They're not about returning the land. So Azania is still, the majority of the land is still owned by Europeans. And if not white Europeans, then Lebanese, Indians, various people, but not Africans. Africans still control the smallest amount of land. They've allowed a tiny percentage to become millionaires, but that's like the exceptional. The majority are still living in poverty or impoverishment. When I was there, in 2016, was it? I think it was, yeah. They, you know, I went to a township and there's still townships with no running water and, you know, it's just, so yeah, that was my kind of real introduction to the road to Pan-Africanism. Before that, I'd done stuff like CND March and various, you know, fight the Alton Bill for women's rights. But yeah, it was really the anti-apartheid stuff. So I've been involved in that. So I saw the abject racism and, you know, I was there when, you know, the Thatcher thing was basically, you know, promoting apartheid. I mean, that was a racist time, and that government were extremely racist. And there was actually something in the newspaper, I think yesterday or the day before, maybe it might've been a few days ago, where they said how, you know, this report of the Thatcher thing, how it was supporting apartheid. And I was like, I put some message like, well, obviously it's like a racist hashtag racist AF, as they say. So what do we expect? So yeah, so that was my my introduction to that, and I've been involved ever since in various aspects of issues to do with our people, to do with the, yeah, the oppression and the destruction and the murder and the devaluation and dehumanization of Africans in the UK and, of course, across the globe, but yeah.
You know what I notice about you as well, because I've been in this, on this trot for a while, that you're fearless. I find you to be fearless. I find you to be willing to be on the front line. I find you uncompromising. I've seen you challenge. You're uncompromising. You know your stuff. You know what I mean? Like you, you can be polite because you use the term AF, but you know, we know what that is. And your resistance, your demonstration of resistance is rooted in facts. You're fearless. You just like, nobody can come tell you nothing.
I don't suffer fools.
No, you don't. You don't suffer fools at all. And in that demonstration that I have witnessed in a number of places, in a number of arenas with you, there for me is a demonstration of how you can remain a woman and still be a warrior. You know what I mean? Like, you don't have to become a man to be a warrior. You don't have to become, you know, stupid and simple to get anyone to listen to you. You can just protest legitimately and command respect. That's what I've seen happen with you. I mean, you just, like, I've seen you when you're in your fun time. You laugh and you giggle. I know, I've seen it. And you dance. I've seen it too. And we share a love of fabrics and culture and, you know, clothes and so we share a love of music that perhaps we can talk about in a bit.
And shopping.
We can talk about that. But certainly the seriousness of the task in hand, we don't play when it comes to that. And we're not just doing it for ourselves, we're doing it for generations to come. And we're doing it remembering that generations gone past laid a foundation and we're building on it. So, you know, from the inside out, from before, toward, in the during, toward the future, in the serious space and in the more playful space, I see you. I see you, and I'm just really, really proud to be associated with you, because, you know, it provides for me a reflection that I need, because sometimes I see people that be like, you know, well, if you're spiritual, you know, you just go on, you just take care. You know what I mean? Like, you know, we just everything's light and everything's just soft, and everything's fine, and then the biggest thing for me is forgiveness. I have a challenge with forgiveness. Because people's definition of forgiveness says to me that when I forgive them, that I free myself. Well, I don't feel like I'm bound if I don't forgive white folk. Like, you know what I mean? Like, if someone keeps doing something to you, you don't forgive them. Neither do you turn your other cheek. I have, you know, it's, for me, it's a nonsense. So I think that spirituality allows for the softness, but it also allows for the fire, for the water, for the, you know, for the solid, you know, pushback, all of that. But some of the teachings I've had don't speak to that. There are increasing ones of us who are saying, you know, the spiritual aspect is important, and we bring fire. You know what I mean? We bring noise. We bring, yeah. We spit and we utter solid, hard positions. You can't just do what you want and then we'll say that's fine, and you know, so you being my reflection is like, okay, it show me your company and I'll tell you who you are kind of thing. And it's really, it's a thrill for me. It's a thrill. I want to tell you, I don't always answer my phone to people when they call me, but when you call me, I answer. So, you talked about scars, which I think is important to talk about. I don't know if we could talk about it right now, but I wanted to pick up on something that you just slipped in there when you were talking about your introduction to activism in a certain form. You spoke about colored people being allowed in. And I want to pick up on that because currently I'm confronted and irritated by the term BAME. The term BAME is not known much outside of the UK. BAME is a label that's been given to some people, and the people who know about it are in the UK. Caribbean doesn't really know about it. The US doesn't really know about it. The African continent doesn't really know about it. You know, there are places that don't know about it. Can you say something to me about this idea of BAME, what your position is on it? And also, I mean, that thought was prompted by the idea of colored people, because I know we fought for political blackness. But yeah, I'd like to hear what your thoughts are, if you have any. And I know you're not really, I mean, you're having to form your thoughts now because this isn't scripted. This conversation isn't scripted. I wanted it like that.
So before I go any further, I'll say, when you said, show me your company and I'll tell you who you are, that's so, so important, that phrase, because my grandmother, who more or less raised me, that was one of her sayings.
Oh, wow.
Show me your company and I'll tell you who you are. No, come live with me. She was, and I take so much, and I, you know, from those, what I call natural, authentic philosophy that we just had. The elder women just said what they had to say, and I'd be like, what? So
yeah.
The one they always use for my mother is, she don't put water in her mouth to talk.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So that's how I see us African queen mother warriors. We don't put no water in our mouth to talk. We talk our talk.
That's right. That's right. Can you say the name of your grandmother and bring her into, you know?
Her name was Bernice Jameson, and her married name was O'Keefe. Well, you know how we have those names, but yeah.
Yes.
Ashay. So, wow. So on the point of BAME, yes, BAME is a terrible.
What does it even mean for people who watch this who don't know?
Minority, black, Asian, minority, ethnic. I mean, it's so ridiculous. BME, which was black, minority, ethnic, was problematic enough. But I could talk for hours just on this term. And quite a number of years ago, before this, everybody was talking about this BAME. This was probably, God, in 2000 and, oh, I can't even think when I started it. Oh, about 2011, just after the Equality Act came out. It came out in 2010. 2011-12, I'd already come up with my own acronym, which was marked communities. And the reasons I came up with it was minoritized, M-A-R-C. Yeah, it was minoritized, African, Asian, racialized groups. So I was going with the term minoritized because first and foremost, the people who are referred to by this acronym BAME in this M, minority, are not minorities.
Mm.
We might be a minority in the UK, but we're the majority of the world.
Yeah.
People who share our melanin content are the majority of the world. Whether they are of African heritage, Asian heritage, other indigenous cultural heritages, and I'm never sure what name to call other people. I don't name people, I only name our people, Africans. I'm not prepared to tell other people how to call themselves. They want to say Indian, Bangladeshi, Pakistani. They want to call themselves, I don't know, indigenous, Americans, and, you know, obviously the indigenous Australians are our people, whatever, Torres Islanders, Maori, all these various terms. All these people are collectively not white. White is the tiny minority. So this acronym where we call minority people who are not white is so inaccurate. All it does is it further exacerbates the falsification of geography, of history, of culture, and whitewashes it. It's just another form of whitewashing. Complete bullshit, not to be polite. So minority doesn't...
Otherwise known as BS.
Yeah, hashtag BS. So we are minoritized because we are the majority, and we then find ourselves in this Babylon place here, and we become minoritized. We're not a minority. So that was why I went with that. African, because as we said, we are Africans. We did political blackness worked when African Americans coined that phrase black. They started because we were named black, negro, negra, all these other, you know, black meaning a color which was then applied to us because of the melanin content in our skin during the enslavement colonization periods. And then African Americans. Now, the what we have to understand is in America, when somebody says that you're black, they're talking about us. We're black. We're not talking about Indians. We're not talking about indigenous Americans. We're not, or original Americans. We're not talking about Chinese people and Polish people and Italians and Lebanese. And we're talking about Africans. There's no debate in America who a black person is. They're African Americans. Hence the Black Power movement, you know, the black, you know, black liberations movement, black theological movements. There's no question. We know what we're talking about in America. They're black. But even in America, some of our more progressive people then move from black to African. They claim that African with a C. Of course, before black, there was Negro, like, you know, late great Honorable Marcus Messiah Garvey, the Universal Negro Improvement Association, you know. So in America, it's clear who black people are. So then we exported some of that into this country, this country that I am presently in, which is called, well, the Divided Kingdom, but some people call it the United Kingdom. I wouldn't call it that. I think that's another story for another day. It's another whitewashing of a narrative. This place ain't united.
The Divided Babylon.
Yeah. Babylon, inner England. So we imported that because we were very much led by the Americans, like you said, you know, American culture and history, because of what the you know, Malcolm X and Martin Luther King and all of that stuff that happened in the 60s with the civil rights movement had a huge impact on us in the Caribbean, on us on the African continent, in this place, in a Babylon here. And we imported this notion of black power. Then of course, in South Africa, in Azania, is very clear again, when you talk about black people, you're not talking about anyone who isn't African. In fact, even unfortunately for me, very sadly, because of my ancestral admixture, I'm not necessarily even considered even black in South Africa, as I was told. I'm considered colored because I have a particular type of hair and skin color, even though my features are quite African, because they're so, you know, the mentality is so messed up. But the point is, to be black, you are African. There's no Lebanese person or Indian person. None of these people get called. So again, like, you know, Steve Biko, I write what I like, you know, black consciousness is very clear. This is blackness to do with Africanness. It equates the same thing. So we imported that in England. People imported it, activists who, you know, I respect and I stand on their shoulders many decades before myself in the 60s, etc. And started talking about black power movement here and all that thing came here. But then, I don't know, I mean, perhaps it's an English thing. It's a kind of, the English are very, very deceitful. They're the most, my mother always said, you know, Americans tell you to your face, the English smile at you and stab you. You know, they're just, they're very twisted, deceitful. The way they use language is convoluted and misleading. So anyhow, in the UK context, black in the 60s and early 70s became this political blackness. So if you're not white, you're black. Now that is the legacy of that has done a lot of damage and has caused a lot of confusion, because of course, if you're not white, you're black. Well, are you really? I mean, back then I accepted it. I mean, my closest friend when I was at school, I had a long history of moving around. I didn't have many friends at school, but my closest friend was Anglo-Indian woman, Asian, darker skin than me. Indian heritage. And we were very close. In fact, she was in the anti-apartheid movement with me. And back in the early 80s, and like when we were like 13, 14, we would have said we were black, because she would have gone with, well, I'm not white, I'm black. That's how she saw herself. But then what happened, and this is the problem, in the late 80s, suddenly these so-called black people, because of course, just to say, many of the black people so-called were Asians, what we now call Asians. They're coming from Bangladesh and Pakistan and India, and they were migrating, because of course, we, people of African heritage, African Caribbean people, we migrated, as you know, the so-called Windrush, but you know, we, the last pattern of migration in the late 40s and 50s, we paved the way. So we fought the skinheads and the, the Teddy Boys, and then the whatever movement, and then the skinheads and all the racist groups. We fought them and we carved our way here. We created these organizations based on the civil rights movement that was happening at the same time. So a lot of them were called Black This, Black That. And we were very happy. And then the Asians came, and of course they now started to face the racism. And we were very embracing. That's the reality. We did what African people have always done. We embraced people and put them under our wing. Said, no, you're black too, man. We're going to stand with you. These people calling you the P word, or these people are saying whatever to you, we're going to stand. We're going to fight your cause. We've set up a union body. You come in. So, you know, that was great. Unity. So they were very happy to be black, because being black was being protected, was being part of a movement that had strong roots. So they were black. And then something happened in the 80s, as you know, both you and I know, the Thatcherite years, the rise of consumerism and you know, the yuppie and they basically, you know, Asian people are less black than us, let's face it. You know, yeah. Many of them are, they're the same ethnic racial group as Asian, as Caucasians. I mean, Caucasians are recessive Asians. So, you know, they became more acceptable than us. Once they speak with an English accent and they dress in a particular way, and they, you know, they then decided they wanted to separate themselves, yeah, for their own prosperity. So then they became Asian. So this B now, there was a black minority ethnic, and they didn't want to be black anymore because they've now progressed. And so they found this A, which was Asian. But somehow we Africans, and you know, actually I don't blame the Asians for wanting to be Asian. Because Asia means the Indian subcontinent. It means Pakistan, Bangladesh, and India. It means there's a history and a culture and a language that they wanted represented in this A. But then, what, we stayed black? So now, Asian represents a people who can pinpoint who they are, and then we remain a black. So we became, and then some people, to add insult to injury, spell black with a lowercase b. Like, we just are black. A black? Where's a black? So this has been the problem. So this acronym now is so inappropriate. And, you know, that's what I learned. I learned that at the end of the day, really, I'm not really black in England. In America, I'm black. I'm happy with that. But in England, I'm an African. Because while other people are claiming their heritage, and then black becomes a dumping ground, because I'm hearing, like, Polish people are claiming to be BAME. I mean, when I was running this race equality partnership, and I was running these projects in health, and I was hearing, oh, well, the Polish are BAME. I was like, well, now it's a joke, because Polish are white. They have to come here. The woman is pregnant. She gives birth in England. The child goes to playgroup and then to nursery school. By the age of 6 or 7, they speak with a perfect British accent, and they will consider them white and English. Your children and my children, born here, their children are born here, and as people, well, where are you from? They still, as far as they're concerned, we don't belong in this country.
That's right.
Even though your mother and my mother, when they were born, had British passports, your grandparents and mine all had British passports, because we were colonized, and our country's built, but for Jamaica, but for Trinidad, but for Barbados, Grenada, St. Kitts, St. Vincent, but for these islands, there'd be no England,
right,
as we know it. So it's a very, I could talk for hours, my sister. I could talk for hours. Yeah.
I have an issue with the BAME thing, because I think it's underhand.
It is.
Way of insulting us. And I think that it has slipped under the radar and entered into the narrative and the vocabulary because people are lazy. I think it's easy to say BAME. You know, when you're talking about a certain population, you say BAME. But in the BAME, you are respecting Asians because you are mentioning Asians. You are including and lumping together something called minority ethnic. But you you have identified and separated out these people called Black. And Black, there is no place called Black. In fact, I know you are something of a music connoisseur, so you will know, I don't know if it's Peter Tosh, but somebody says as long as you're a Black man, you're an African. It just is no matter where you come from, as long as you're a Black man, you're an African. That we have been schooled in a system that does not link us to the continent. And then we grow up, and as adults, we are being categorized as people who don't have a heritage, a legacy, a contribution. So that people are very comfortable saying things like we're Black British. Well, I'm not sure that you even know what that means. It means that you're connected with a brutish people. Because if you know anything about the British history, you will know that British are brutish. They have built the great name that they claim on acts of murder and violations, human rights violations. They have got rich and fat of the exploitation of people that when you confront them with it, they'll say, well, at the time it was legal, which in itself is a further insult. You know, so that at the time you weren't human is pretty much what they're saying. At the time, mm-hmm. you weren't human. And a lot of policies and legislation and if you go onto the government website, you'll see they still have this idea that, you know, ethnic means Black. And that's not my understanding of what ethnic means at all. So, but what they're saying is, if you're white, you're, you know, ethnic minorities or ethnicities are applicable to people who are not white. But then who are the white and how many people are passing as white and how many people within the BAME grouping exploit other members of the BAME grouping? So for me, a lot of, you've mentioned Polish, we can mention Asian because it's actually the A was added, the A was added to BME to make it easier to pronounce as BAME, but also to identify a population of people who are separating themselves out from Black. And those people separating themselves out from Black are able to access funding because they're in the same BAME grouping, which further disadvantages people who are of African heritage. So for me, it's really fascinating because this struggle, this situation is going on unbeknown to the wider diaspora. People in the States don't know this is going on. You know, we're not very good, I don't think, at letting people know in other places, other Africans know this is what they're doing to us over here. We are far too polite, as far as I'm concerned. Far too polite. I don't want to be polite. I'm, you know, I don't know if I'm going to have to eat dry bread for the rest of my days because ain't nobody going to want to give me a job. But I'm about tired of this. I think, you know, coming back to the movement and us as African Queen Mother Warriors, you know, in that movement, we have these conferences and we have these debates and webinars and whatever it is we do. And I'm really keen to ensure that all people everywhere understand that these things affect African women in a particular way. When we watch that our children are being arrested and abused by so-called police officers who have sworn to protect and serve. We as mothers and fathers, but we as mothers have a particular experience, you know, because we birth these children. We don't even need to know anybody's name. We just know that our children are in danger. Our children are in danger. This is a human situation. This is personal.
More than human. It's a species situation. Any creature will fight to the death for its young.
Right. And you're right. But what I meant by that is BAME dehumanizes.
Yes.
The Pan-African movement even does not hear the voice of the woman.
Yes.
And I'm saying that we are affected because, I mean, you mentioned scars early on. We are affected in a certain kind of way. I would go so far as to say we have spiritual fibroids, things that you won't see in an MRI scan, but that we know is there. There's a lump there. You know, there's a growth there. There's a heaviness that we feel in our breasts when things happen. We actually feel it, you know. One may want to argue, well, if we can't see it under a microscope, it doesn't exist. Well, you know, I want to tell you that you can't see my labor pain under a microscope, actually, but I'm feeling it. You know what I mean? Don't tell me I'm not to push. I know when I'm to push. You know what I mean? I'm feeling it. Don't tell me how to wail and to bawl out. You don't know at which point the pain will be so tremendous that it makes me wail. You can't tell me, this is the time you're to cry. This is the time you're to stop. And this is the way you should feel. And no, that can't be happening to you because we have done research on it. And in these publications, they say that Black people don't really feel pain. So you shouldn't be feeling this yet. You know what I mean? Like, what are you talking about? Who told you you can tell us how we should feel? You know, this is about us claiming without apology our personhood, our spirituality, our legacy, our entitlement, our fury. I love a shiny thing, right? I love shiny things. I love shiny things. I love cultural things. I got my earrings, you know, I'll swap them out when I'm ready.
I love the earrings, sis.
I love those things. Don't take that away from me because I'm in the movement. I still want those things. I still want to hold on to that. You don't tell me. It's like the church thing. If you're a good church sister, you're not supposed to wear makeup. What? Good church sisters not wearing makeup are sleeping with the pastor, if you don't want to know. You know, I'm not supposed to say that. Oh, you ain't supposed to say that, Sandra, because I ain't right. But it's the truth.
Yeah.
Pastor's getting his juice off of, you know, Sister Science over there on a Monday and Sister Science over there on a Friday. And the pastor's wife can't say nothing. You know what I mean? Like, there's some stuff that we have to deal with. I don't want us to end our conversation without talking about music. Because I know you love music.
I do.
I know you do.
You're always telling us about the latest concert you're going to and the latest this you're listening to, the latest that.
I love music. I love music. One of the things about your, maybe you can say something about your radio program when it, you know, where we will hear it and when it comes on. Because I know when I've listened, I've been exposed to a really wide, and I do love music, and I know a lot about music, but when I listen to your show, I get exposed to more music, and more musicians, and more cultural warriors, and not just from the UK, but around the world. Your reach is quite phenomenal. Can you say something about how you got to be doing that? And how important that is in terms of your identity and what you're doing, even before these crazy COVID times and during this COVID times.
I think I've always loved, well, I think I've always loved music ever since I was young, and spending a lot of my teenage years in the UK and in other parts of Europe, I was exposed to all sorts of music, which very kind of like, you know, from growing up, in, obviously in Trinidad, you know, there was one type of music, and my mother and her blues and her jazz and soul. But then also I was exposed to the 1980s movement, the kind of like new romantics and a David Bowie and the rock. And I love all that too. And I think I'm extremely eclectic in my tastes, but at the core, fundamentally, I love African music. Like with everything else that resonates through me is my Africanness. And because all music originates in Africa anyway, it's you know, as its core, you always, my friend Alexander the Great, the Calypsonian, wrote, wherever there's music, you always find a black man or woman, as he says. So essentially, we are the creators of that art form, that cultural form. And so I do a show on a Friday, which is with a kind of local station. There's a couple of white guys, you know, friends of mine, and we have this very fun, lighthearted kind of magazine show, and play all, they, you know, mainly they play the music, and I'll chuck in a few tracks myself, but they do the music. And it's very kind of, you know, very mixture of everything. But when I was starting this radio show, Speak Your Truth, the idea came to me that I wanted to present the narratives from around African diasporan narratives from African diasporan people and from the continent, if that was possible, you know, technology allowing, because sometimes it's difficult to get good connections on the continent on Wi-Fi and stuff. But my idea was that I would have a show where the voices would be heard. And so I frame it as a conversation, speak your truth. So I'm having a conversation with someone, they're speaking their truth. So it's about them, it's not about me. Because sometimes as well, I'm really interested in presenting and all of these forms. Though what I sometimes find is a lot of ego with the presenter, where it's almost they're trying to show what they know and they're trying to almost take space. And I wanted to give space. I wanted the space to be the person who I'm having the conversation with. So it's their truth, it's not about my truth. And within that, I love music. And I wanted to be able to have a Pan-African perspective to what I do. And I thought, I'm going to focus on African voices. And I'm going to focus on African music on my show. I love all sorts of music. And in other spaces, I'll play rock. I'll play all sorts of, people might be, what? All sorts of things. However, in this space, in this show, if I'm speaking my truth is that I want other people's truth. So I want to hear their truth. And so my show embodies a Pan-African perspective and engaging conversation. And so I want eclectic music, and I use the term eclectic within the context of Africa. And when I say Africa, I mean Africa and the world. So the music I play can be American continent, it can be the African continent, and any of the countries on the African continent, all can be included. And the European continent, Africans, and you know, producing music there. It could be wherever I find it. So I set out every week and I produce a playlist with music, stuff that I love, old stuff, new stuff, Afro beats, hip hop, jazz, blues, you know, everything.
Your show is very, very engaging. I find that the time seems to go really fast during your show. I remember I was driving somewhere once and I was listening to your show, and it takes me like, I don't know, 25 minutes to get to where I'm going, and your show had finished before. Like, I mean, I must admit, I did pull over to listen. Still, it was like, what? But I pulled over to listen. Is, you know, it was gone so quickly. It's so engaging. Like,
it's 2 hours long, though.
It's 2 hours long.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, I don't know what happened. I don't know what happened, but I know I was listening to it and I pulled over because I thought, you know, let me, you know, I was near a beach, I must admit. I pulled over and the individual wanted to hear it. And I was, and I had some juice and I settled myself down to just enjoy it. And I enjoyed it for a while and then it was over. I was like, oh, I wanted some more of that. The stories, the space you give to the person to be able to share is, as you say, different from what others may do. So I was really, you know, so it's on which radio station?
The Ferity Radio, which again, F-E-R-F-E-R-I-T-Y. It's a Yoruba word and it kind of means like panache, you know, style for Ferity. Hey.
Yes.
Created by a brother called DJ Freestyle. He's from Sierra Leone.
Okay.
And he's created the station. He's got a long history of working on other radio stations. And what I love about Ferity is practically all the DJs are women, all the presenters.
Wow.
There was, up until a couple of months ago, there was only two male, him and one other brother. Now they've got two young brothers, so there's four of them, but all the rest of us are females.
Wow. That in itself is something.
Yeah, that drew me. When I came, I felt like, yes, I like this space.
That's not typical. So is there a track that you would like to just, that comes to mind right now that you'd like to hear before we close out?
Is there a track?
Can I give you a chance to think about it while I play one?
Yes, you play a track and let me think.
You think about
track, but then thinking, will you be able to get the track or would I have to give you the name of it? If I take the name out of here, out of my phone, and then I send it to you, then you can play it. So you play a track, I'll get the name because you probably have to, I don't know if you'll be able to find it because the thing that just came to my mind, but let me just get it and then I should be able to send it to you.
Well, whatever happens, we'll make it work. I think that would be, you know, like, we can do this. We can do this. It just means, so you'll send it to me. In the meanwhile,
yeah, you're going to play a track for me or for yourself.
Don't you where you come from? As long as you're a black man, you're an African. No mind your nationality, you have got the identity of an African. 'Cause if you come from Clarendon, and if you come from Portland, and if you come from Westmoreland, you're an African. So don't care where you come from, as long as you're a black man, you're an African. No mind your nationality, I've got the identity of an African. 'Cause if you come from Trinidad, and if you come from African. So don't care where you come from, as long as you're a black man, you're an African. No mind your complexion, there is no rejection, you're an African. 'Cause if your flexion high, 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 your flexion low, and if your flexion in between, you're an African. So don't care where you come from, as long as you're a black man, you're an African. No mind denomination, that is only segregation, you're an African. 'Cause if you go to the Catholic, you
So don't care where you come from, as long as you're a black man, you're an African. No mind your nationality, I've got the identity of an African.
The lovely man.
Yes, that's
he was an African.
So I'm gonna look for the ones that you've sent now.
Yeah, the second link.
The second link? Okay.
Yeah, the first one I sent you was off the thing, and I realized unless you've got the Amazon thing, you can't play it. So I just quickly found it and sent it to you again.
I don't know what the Amazon thing is.
Yeah, just don't worry about that.
You young people, you got all these things that you keep doing. So what I'm going to try and do is
the second one is a basically a YouTube link, so you can use it.
All right. Don't think say something about why you selected it while I try and set it up.
Okay, Sanibo Say is a young artist. Now she's based somewhere in Europe, and she just does beautiful music. I think actually that when you go into it, I think there's one above that has the lyrics on it actually, which you might want to play. So Sanibo Say, trying to remember what her heritage actually is. It's from the continent and Europe. She's mixed heritage. And she's got a beautiful voice, and she does just amazing music. And I hadn't heard of her widely. And I was kind of doing some research. She's Swedish. She's a Swedish and African heritage. And she's quite young still, 1990. So she's a young thing. And she does a very kind of eclectic range of music. Gambian, that's it. I knew there was a reason. Gambia, I should know that because of my connection to Gambian and Swedish heritage. Okay. And Gambia, like my special home on the continent.
So I don't know if this one has the lyrics, but I'll play her anyway because
and the tune is called Words, and because we've been talking about language and this acronym and what these words mean, it just came to mind.
Okay, cool, let's do it.
You say is the word.
Very nice. Very nice.
Chosen something by Nina Simone or Camille Yarborough, or I could have. There's so many other queens that. But I felt like this is a young sister, and she's got. And also, I just loved her that on the album. I just love her expression.
Yes. Very striking image.
Yeah.
Exactly. Very nice sound. A very deep message. And I'm not familiar with her, so thank you for introducing her to my consciousness anyway. So we've been talking for a while. I don't know if you have
anything.
I didn't expect we were going to be talking for so long, but then I enjoy our conversations. I realize it's just, you know, I let it run on. Is there anything?
Happened.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, I really value sister spaces. I really, really do. I think they're underrated. I think that coming from a Eurocentric position, especially, sometimes sisters are seen as a threat to sisters. And I'm not from that school. I'm from the school of when a sister's making it, I feel good because it introduces the possibilities for not just me, but for other sisters and for our children to come. So are there any closing things you want to say before I stop recording?
No, I would just say give thanks for the space and the time and the conversation, and you know, there's many, many more to come.
Yes. Give thanks.
Baby, fresh on the beat and it's killing them all, of course. It's killing them all, of course. Make we scatter this place tonight. Dance and sweat till life's in a fight.